Hello everyone, and welcome to another video about Qt containers in Qt 5 and Qt 6. I am Giuseppe D'Angelo. In this video, I'm going to explain to you how the Qt associative containers work. What is an associative container? An associative container is a container that simply maps keys to values. So, those are containers that are a bit different from sequential containers, containers in which you access by index or by position. Typically, associative containers are accessed by giving a key of an arbitrary data type and retrieving the value which corresponds to that key. The ones that are available in Qt are these four: QMap, QMultiMap, QHash, and QMultiHash. They all behave pretty much the same. That is, they all map keys to values. There are a few differences between them. The biggest difference, of course, has to do with the fact that they use different data structures to perform this mapping, and these different data structures give us different complexity guarantees and therefore different invariants, if you want. And of course, there is the difference between the simple version and the multi version. The multi versions of these containers allow for duplicated keys. So in a QMultiMap or in a QMultiHash, you can have the same key multiple times. There is also QSet. QSet technically is an associative container which behaves like a QHash. That is, it is not ordered, unlike standard set from the standard library. But it's a QHash that maps keys to, well, nothing. It's just a container of keys, really, because that's what a set is. If you want to have a look about what these container classes look in code, take a look at this slide. So what I have here is a simple class called QMap between strings and integers. And you have all the familiar APIs for insertion, lookup, and so on. So for instance, you can use the subscript operator, the square brackets, as a form of retrieval, but also as a form of insertion. So you're asking whether you're asking to insert a new key called John and map 42 to that key. There is a contains method that allows you to look up whether a given map contains a given key. And then I'm using, again, the subscript operator, this time for retrieving the data out of the map in order to print it. Yes, the slide says look up, but don't do this. Why is that? Because I'm accessing the map twice to retrieve the same key. That sounds not efficient. So a better approach would be to use, for instance, find, and find will return an iterator pointing to the given key. And if that iterator is not pointing to the end of the map, then you know that you've got it. So you can actually print the value and the key corresponding to that iterator. So let's discuss the two big families of containers that we have in Qt. The first family is about maps, so QMap and QMultiMap. What do they have in common is that they are both sorted associative containers, meaning that the key value pairs inside a map or inside a multimap are kept sorted in a key order. So if you, for instance, iterate of a QMap, you will see that all your keys will appear in key order. There is an order induced over the keys, and that's the order you get out of the map. So how does Qt possibly know that how to keep the order of given keys? Well, that's pretty simple. The keys inside the QMap must implement operator less than. That's a given if you're using things like integers or strings or something like that. But even if you have your custom key type, you can always implement operator less than between two instances, two objects of your key type. And once you do that, then you will be able to use your custom key type as indeed a key inside a QMap. Under the hood, you could imagine where this is going. How does QMap keep things ordered? Well, the answer is pretty simple. It uses a binary search tree. In particular, it may use some more advanced search tree, such as a binary red-black tree or something like that. And this also gives us an idea of the complexity of the operations over a map or over a multi-map. That is that insertion, retrieval, lookup, removal, are going to have a cost which is logarithmic in the number of entries inside the map. And that's simply because the depth of such a binary search tree is logarithmic in the number of entries. The other family of containers are the hashes. So QHash, QMultiHash, and also QSet, because QSet behaves like a QHash. those are the non-ordered associative containers. That is, they still map keys to values, just like QMap, just like QMultiMap. But the difference is that these ones don't preserve any specific order over your keys. So an iteration will retrieve elements from a QHash or from a QMultiHash in some random order. This order is not guaranteed to be stable. It can change throughout your application when you manipulate the hash. So don't rely on it at any given time. And what's the trade-off? I mean, you're giving away the ordering. What are you getting back? You're getting back, in general, faster operations on these data structures. So you're getting back pretty much amortized constant time insertion lookup removal inside a QHash, QMultiHash, or QSet. Under the hood, this is done in a couple of different ways. In Qt 5, this is done by using chains of buckets. In Qt 6, this is done using open addressing. But that's kind of an implementation detail. Don't rely on that. Apart from this, the usage of these classes is extremely similar to QMap and QMultiMap. If you're familiar with the hashing tables, you should know how they work under the hood. That is, in order to perform this very fast lookup, given a key, I'm able in almost constant time to figure out if the key is there or not there, and if it's there, to give you the associated value. How can it do it? I mean, it must have a little bit of help, and indeed it has. If you have a custom data type that you want to use as a key inside an unordered associative container, such as a QHash, then QHash is going to require from your key type to implement a few things. There are at least two things that you must implement. One is an equality operator, but that's easy. And the second thing that you must implement is a hashing function. That is a function that takes instances of your key and returns values, small integers typically. And then QHash can use these integers to do this fast lookup operation. In Qt, the hashing function is called QHash. That's QHash with a lowercase q and uppercase h. And that's the function which is responsible to take objects of your key type, process them somehow, and turn them into a very small integer so that QHash, this time with a capital Q, capital H, the data structure, so that that data structure can actually do this very fast lookup. Now, Qt obviously comes with QHash overload for a lot of data types that are from the C++ language, so like int, double, and similar, but also data types that come with Qt, things like QString or QDate, QTime, and similar. So if you want to build a QHash, which is an integer or a QString as a key type, just go ahead, do it, because Qt is filling the gaps for you and it's providing this QHash implementation for you. However, if you do want to create a QHash with a type of yours as a key type, then you will need to overload QHash also for your custom key type. The way this works is pretty straightforward. All you need to do is just to provide and overload the QHash taking objects of your key type. However, QHash must also satisfy a little contract. And the contract is quite simple. In a nutshell, the QHash hashing function must be a function. That is, inputs which compare equal, must also result in identical outputs from QHash. So if you have two objects and according to your custom comparison, those two objects are actually equal, then whatever QHash returns must be exactly the same for both objects. Pretty simple. So it must be a function in the mathematical sense. On top of that, although it's not strictly required, it would be very nice if also your hashing function had some extra properties. That is, it should really be fast and, well, not slow. That goes without saying, because the whole point of this exercise is to make fast lookups. And if your hashing function is terribly slow, that's not going to be good. But the second interesting property is that your hashing function must be built in a way that minimizes collisions. That is, different inputs should ideally be mapped onto different outputs. This is not, in general, easy to do, and in fact, there are a couple of strategies to create such hashing functions, but nonetheless, this should be ideal, because if you have a hashing function with lots of which generates lots of collisions, this also means that the data structure, the Q hash with the capital Q, is going to have lots of conditions internally, and that will downgrade its performances. So precisely, what you need to do in order to provide such a hashing function is to overload to create pretty much a function with this signature. It's a Q hash, passing your custom key types as the first argument, and returns uint, and also takes an extra parameter called a seed as a uint. Typically, we don't invent brand new hashing functions all the time. Typically, we use pre-existing hashing functions and we just combine them in clever ways in order to hash our own key type. So say that our key type is the combination of a string, like a name, and a date of birth, or something like that. Then all we do inside such a hashing function is that we combine the respective hashes for the string, so the name, the date of birth, and so on. And how do we do that practically in code? Well, that's a bit too long to discuss here today, but I'm going to leave a couple of links in the video description about how to actually implement such a hashing function. Now, coming to Qt 6, what has changed with the associative containers in Qt? Not much. Qt 6 still has the same associative containers. There have been just a few API cleanups and also some internal implementations, something that hopefully doesn't affect your code in any way. You just see that the Qt 6 containers either use less memory or are generally speaking faster. The first change actually happened between Qt 5 and Qt 6, but also within Qt 5, in Qt 5.15, there's been a number of changes in preparation for this one. That is, in Qt 5, for some reason, the Qt multi containers, the multi-map and the multi-hash, used to inherit from QMap and QHash. Inherit in the object-oriented programming term. Those classes were subclasses of the respective single-keyed ones. That was a bit weird, and also it was weird because, actually speaking, concretely speaking, QMap and QHash were multi-keyed containers in Qt 5. No one expects this from a QMap or a QHash. Nobody expects that you can actually insert duplicated keys. But you could. For instance, you could just create a QMultiMap, insert duplicated keys, and then cast it to its base class, to QMap. And now what you have is a QMap which contains those duplicated keys. This caused a lot of confusion and also some very subtle bugs because code generally does not expect single keyed containers to actually have duplicated keys. And so what happened within Qt 5 is that this multi-keyed behavior of the single key classes got completely deprecated. And the encouragement there is that if you do need multi-key behavior, pass the multi-containers, don't pass the single containers. In Qt 6, this inheritance chain got broken entirely. So multi-containers no longer inherit from the single containers. And when it comes to the non-ordered associative containers, so QHash and QMultiHash, there have been a couple of changes there as well. The first interesting change is that the QHash signature has changed. So the overloads that you would write in Qt 5 returned and took a uint, but that uint has now changed to a size t, so potentially to 64-bit parameter and return value on 64-bit architectures. This is a minor, mild change. The Qt 5 versions still work, although at the expense of perhaps some compiler warning telling you that you're passing in something too big for the parameter, stuff like that. It's just a minor annoyance at this moment when doing a port from Qt 5 to Qt 6. If you really want to have some code compile and work without warnings in both Qt 5 and Qt 6, my recommendation would be to have a small ad hoc data type that you define as a type def to either uint or qsetType, depending on which version of Qt you're targeting. And then you can declare your custom qhash overloads in function of these ad hoc data type. However, there is also another possibility in case you want, in Qt 6, specifically starting from 6.1, qhash, the data structure, also supports standard hash as a hashing function. So if you have a data type that supports, that you want to store as a key inside a qhash, rather than overloading qhash with lowercase q, you can actually do another thing. You can actually specialize standard hash And the benefit of this is that now your data type will be usable as a key type in, of course, QHash, but also in the standard library unordered associative containers. Another interesting side effect of this is that now standard library data types, for which the standard library provides a standard hash specialization, work out of the box as keys in QHash. So now you can have a QHash of a standard string now without the need of defining a custom QHash overload. And speaking of the implementation of these associative containers in Qt6, I mentioned at the beginning of this video that these containers, the QHash, QSet, QMultiHash, have been re-implemented in Qt6. So instead of using bucketed chains, now they use open addressing. That's a different way to implement a hash table. It works. It's very similar to other hash tables available if you want on the market. So something like Dessel's Robby map or something like Flathash map from Absales. The good part about this is that this gives, typically speaking, significant performance gain due to the fact that the data is more compact in memory and you don't have lots and lots of memory allocations. On the other hand, in some very remote scenario, if you had code that was relying somehow on stable integrity references when you mutate such a container, that integrity references is now gone. That is, you can no longer rely on it. This may once more introduce some hard-to-detect bugs in code. This is probably a very good piece of advice, that is, try and avoid keeping references alive while manipulating Qt containers. We've seen it already a couple of times in previous videos in this series. It's a bad idea. Just don't do it. Don't manipulate containers while you keep references, pointers, iterators alive over that container. That concludes this video. Thank you very much for watching. In the next video of this series, I'm going to, if you want, attempt to give an answer to the question, which container should I use? Should I use the ones coming from Qt? Should I use the ones coming from the standard library? Well, I'll try my best to give you an answer to this very complicated question. So stay tuned for this upcoming video. Subscribe to our channel. And as usual, have a good day.